whose faith let us declare.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated, please. Great to see everyone in God's house. Welcome to the Lord's house on this day that we continue to celebrate the resurrection of our Savior. I hope that everybody had got a bulletin as you came in, and also that everybody's had a chance, if you haven't done so already, to sign in the registration pad. There's a little booklet at the end of the pew, and we would love for you to sign that booklet. Give us your name, give us your address, give us good information so we can reach out to you. And also, there are little boxes that are difficult to read. If you can't read that box, then find somebody with better eyes than you to read that for you. And let us know if you're a visitor in our midst so we can welcome you well. Or if you'd like the pastor to come, if we have something that we need to pray for you about, we want to reach out to you. And we do use those to serve you. Also, it's a good way to let us know if you'll be with us this Wednesday for Wednesday night supper. And we've got great plans for our Wednesday night program, which continues to grow. And so we would love for you to be with us this Wednesday, but do let us know if you'll be there to eat supper. Also, speaking of visitors, we have something new. Yay! We've got coffee cups. And I always like to have another coffee cup. I love to have a mug. And so we have just purchased a whole bunch of mugs so that we can give these to people who visit our church. We have a staff member who's not a member of our church, which is great. We need that during the day. We've got Cindy in our office who loves Jesus, but she goes and visits other churches, and they give coffee cups. And so if you come by the office, we've got all these coffee cups from all the other churches in town, which is great. And we say, we need to get some coffee cups to give to our visitors. So if you would like to have a coffee cup and you are already a part of our church, we want you to have a coffee cup, but we would like for you to help us to fund this outreach to our visitors by giving us $5, which is just a little bit more than the coffee cup costs us, okay? And we have a basket and we've got some coffee cups in the atrium. If you're a visitor, we want you to have one for free. Get a coffee cup. And as you're drinking your coffee and you see that cross and flame, pray for your church and know that your church is praying for you. And so that's something new for all of us. So that's a real blessing. Where is my thing with all the announcements there? No, it isn't. I've lost my list with my announcements. I just saw it a moment ago. Where is it? It's on my Bible. That's where it is. Thank you, thank you. I need all the help I can get. Twice now Matthew has gone and got my sermon notes for me from the office after church has started. Speaking of Matthew, Matthew is starting a new ministry tomorrow. He's starting a Bible study at Chipola College for college students. And it's going to meet in the chapel at Chipola College. We've got a number of college students in our church, and they have friends. And I just want to say thank you to Matthew also, and also to Steve Young, who's really been very helpful in planning this new mission. It's going to begin for how long?
6 weeks.
6 weeks. 6 weeks. And so that starts tomorrow. It's 6 o'clock. Thank you, Matthew. Thank you, Steve. I've been praying and dreaming that we would have this ministry since I first saw that chapel. I'm so excited, and it's a great blessing. So, we are about to start stewardship. Stewardship is a time to talk about God's use of His gifts that He gives to us. It's also a time to talk about budgeting for the coming year. And budgeting is about the ministry that God has called us to. Our finance committee has just put together a provisional budget. There's going to be a fairly significant increase this year in the budget versus last year because we have a new pastor. Fortunately, our increase to the budget is going to be much less than just his salary and benefit package. So a lot of people have worked very hard to make sure that we are going to cut no ministry, that all of our programmatic ministry is going to stay the same, or we'll get an increase in budget. But we have been able to trim all kinds of operations. We're spending less on apportionments and on insurance and all kinds of stuff. So I'm grateful to folks who are maximizing the church's resources to do ministry. Throughout the stewardship campaign, which will begin at the beginning of October and will conclude at the end of October, throughout that time, we're going to be using a little book that will help us to learn about God's word about how we use our money. I've learned that when people say they don't like to hear about money at church, the one thing they don't want to hear is, give us more. They don't like to hear that. But I have learned that people do want to know what God says to help them find peace in their use of money. They want to know what resources there are to get out of the chaos that we oftentimes experience in our financial lives. And so we have a little book called Earn, Save, Give that is based on John Wesley, who is the founder of Methodism, John Wesley's teaching on practical tips on how to use money in a Christian way. The basis of it is earn all you can, save all you can, give all you can. And that sounds very, very basic. But to learn what those three things mean is very, very, very important. So if you look in your bulletin, there's a place where you can order a book. They're $14, and we encourage everybody to write your name on there, and we will order a book for you so you can read along with our sermon series throughout stewardship. Also, our young people, our teenagers, will be going to Compass Lake next week after church, so make sure if you have a teenager to let them know to be here next week for a trip to Compass Lake. And this afternoon, the Children's Council is meeting at 1 o'clock. One last thing, I'm going away on a mission trip on Tuesday. I'll be in Rwanda in Africa for 10 days. And so if you need a pastor, then we've got one over here. I will not be able to take your call in Rwanda, but I do, in all seriousness, ask you to pray for me and ask that God will bless the mission that I'll be doing in Rwanda. I look forward to sharing what I have experienced and discovered and what God has done in my heart when I return. And I'm very grateful because many of you have supported the trip in various ways, financially, through encouragement, and through your prayers, and I ask you to continue to pray for me as I go on this mission. And Matthew's going to come and lead us in prayer.
Before we pray, we got a lot to celebrate this week, including the birth of Rhett Wheeler Isabellum, the son of Charlie and Jana Isabellum. We have Nathan going on his trip, so we want to make sure that we're praying for him and celebrating his mission. And some other names I want to lift up to you are Teresa Collins, Frank Bondurant, Marilyn Ziegler, Mark Vickery, Dick Beard, Roy Sheffer, Gene Harris, Donald Mathis, Larry Kiesling is having knee surgery, Kim Walters had ankle surgery this week and is recovering from that, and then we also want to remember all those affected by Hurricane Florence. And we also want to have a special prayer for Bradley Flowers as he has gone to help restore power to all those who have lost it. So let us remember all these names as we go to the Lord in prayer. Holy God, we praise your great name here this morning, and thank you for allowing us to gather. We pray for those who are not able to gather this morning because of the hurricane and because of the flooding. Be with those who are right now without a home. Care for those who are hurting and grieving. Be merciful, provide comfort, bring peace, and heal all those who are suffering and those who have distress and fear. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and let your love surround them. Send your spirit to empower your people to do the work of your kingdom, whether that is going to serve the hurricane victims or serving your people right here in Marianna. Let us hear your voice and follow your lead. Lord, be with Nathan as he travels to Rwanda this week. Protect him, teach him, and fill him with your spirit as he joins in where your Holy Spirit is working and moving in Rwanda. We thank you for his mission and for his servant's heart. And Lord, we thank you that we have the ultimate example in your Son to follow. And we thank you that he taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
Good morning. How are y'all this morning? Slowly but surely we come on down. It's good to see y'all. I love to play games. Do you like to play games? I do too. Well, we're going to play a game today. And it's called True or False Game. Okay? But you have to do a certain thing. You know, true means that it's right. False means it's wrong. And so to play this game, you got to hold your tongue. Can you hold your tongue? Uh-huh. You can do it. I know it's not ladylike, but you can do it. Oh, look, Brother Nathan's got here. And so the first question I'm going to ask you is, every person has a unique tongue. True or false? True. You are so right about that. Do you know it's kind of like a thumbprint? It's a print, okay? Next question. All of your estimated 10,000 taste buds are located on the tongue. True or false? False. Did y'all look at my lesson before today? False. Do you know that some of them are in your cheek and in your tongue, on your lips? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. All right. Close to 50% of the bacteria in your mouth lives on your tongue.
That's
true. True, yeah. So don't put your hands in your mouth. You can do it after a while, though. Okay, if a human tongue was proportioned the same way as a chameleon, a person who's 5 feet tall, that's almost me, would have a tongue over 7 feet tall. True. That's true. The chameleon's tongue is 1.5 times the length of its body. All right, one more. In Tibet, it's bad manners to stick your tongue out. No, that's false. They consider that a good manner. I'm glad I don't live in Tibet, China. Because I tell you what, somebody stick their tongue out at me, I don't know what I would do. Okay, well, that was fun, wasn't it? Well, listen. In your mouth, we do things to keep it clean, don't we? We brush our teeth. How many of you brushed your teeth this morning? Yes, yes. I'm glad. Especially if I'm sitting by you. And we put toothpaste on it to kill all the sugar bugs that are in there, don't we? And we floss our teeth, and if you're old like Miss Nolan, you like to use these cute little things right here. They're so much easier than this string stuff. And to make our breath smell so good, we put some mouthwash in our mouth. You don't want to sit by somebody with stanky old breath, do you? No, you don't, do you? But you know what? All of that we're talking about in our mouth in the Bible, in James 3, it says that our tongue is like a fire and that no human can put that fire out. You know what? Only God can take care of that fire on our tongue. And you know, it's really in our heart. That's where it all starts, in our heart. Not in our tongue, but in our heart. So if we have a good heart that is with Jesus, then we will say the right things, won't we? But one nice thing about it is, we all make mistakes, don't we? I know you think I'm perfect, Bo, but I'm not. I make mistakes. And you know what? That's the wonder of our Jesus, that we can ask for permission for our sins to be forgiven. So let's remember about our tongue, and it say nice things. And remember that it all starts within our heart, okay? Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Dear Lord, we just thank you that you live in our hearts so that whatever we say and do will be from our heart because we love you. And all God's children said, Amen.
Lord, I just pray as we turn to collect these tithes and these offerings, that you bless them. Lord, we thank you that we can worship you in so many different ways. And Lord, may we worship you with our tithes. In your holy name we pray.
Oh,
Hymnals to number 57, our hymn of preparation is number 57, O Four, A Thousand Tongues to Sing, and we will sing all of the many verses. Reading of God's Word, our text this morning comes from the book of James. I invite you to turn in your Bible to the epistle of James. If you don't know where James is in your Bible, you will find it after Hebrews. And so it's right near the back. If you've gotten to Revelation, you've gone too far, but it's near the end. And we'll be reading from James chapter 3 today. And our reading comes from the first verse. We'll read from through the 12th verse. Now listen for God's word as we share it together today. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For all of us make many mistakes. Amen? Yes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Look at ships. And though they're so large, it takes strong winds to drive them, yet they're guided by a very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. And so also the tongue is a small member, but it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by a small fire. The tongue is a fire. Is placed among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body. It sets on fire and is itself set on fire by hell. Every species of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species, but no one can tame the tongue. A restless animal full of deadly poison. With it, bless the Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. And from the same mouth come both blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers, yield olives? Or a grapevine, figs? No more can salt water yield fresh. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated, please. Well, we're in our third week in the book of James, and we began on the first week talking about how James is a book that deals with our behavior. It's very practical. We oftentimes want to learn what God wants us to do. We want something practical. And then what James tells us makes us say, I don't know that I want to hear that. You know, Mark Twain says, he gets blamed for saying all kinds of things, but there is a quote out there that I've seen where Mark Twain said, it's not the parts of the Bible that I don't understand that give me trouble. It's the parts that I do understand. And so James makes it very plain, very simple for us, but very difficult for us. And if we weren't careful, we would feel this burden placed upon us to be taught to live in a way that we've struggled to live, but we found ourselves unable to live. And so from the beginning, James says that God is a good God. He is a good Father. God is a good Father who gives good gifts to his children. And everything that we have is a result of God's graciousness to us. And so to live as a Christian in the world is to know that freely and not of our own deserving and not because of anything that we've done or not because of who we are or how we were born or inclinations or anything else, God has loved us and blessed us for free. So, responsibility. How many of y'all are familiar with that word, responsibility? Our parents taught us responsibility. And responsibility is important. Amen? Yes, responsibility is important. But many times we think that responsibility is about what I do because I've been taught this is what I ought to do. For a Christian, the ability to respond comes from God's action. God makes the first move. He is gracious and he gives to us and empowers us to live as a response of his goodness that is free. Now, that may seem like a subtle difference, but it makes all the difference in the world. And we're never trying to fill up an empty hole. We're never trying to climb a ladder to God. And we've already been given God's favor for free. And because we've been given that for free, we live out of gratitude. That's the foundation of all that James says to us. And today, he teaches us about our words. As a child, you may have heard this phrase, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me." Now, many times as a child, I got a beating. Sometimes from my mother, sometimes from my dad, sometimes from the other boys on the playground. Right? And I gave a few of those beatings too, and I don't remember them very well. But I remember words. It might be that the words are more painful than the sticks and stones. When I was a little boy, I had a long leash. I was allowed to just roam the neighborhood. Do y'all remember being able to roam the neighborhood? I would get on my bike and I would roam the neighborhood. But I had a boundary. I was told you cannot cross this major intersection that had six lanes of traffic. If you cross that at 9 years old, you might get hit by a car and killed. All right? Do not cross that boundary. Do you think that was good advice from my parents? What do you think I did? And when I was little, I collected G.I. Joes, and I was aware that Kmart, you could get knockoff G.I. Joe plastic guns that I would give to my G.I. Joes, you know, because I wanted them to have extra guns, you know? Does this make sense to you? Yeah. So I crossed this huge, big road. I remember the name of it. It was Merlin Road in Santa Fe. I crossed this road, and I went into the Kmart, and I bought this pack of extra guns. They weren't G.I. Joe brand. They were bargain brand, no-name brand, G.I. Joe knockoff guns, okay, little plastic guns. I was so proud of myself because I had saved money. It was the beginning of Nathan being a cheapskate. And I came back, and I wanted to tell my parents because I was a kid, and I wanted to brag to my parents, but I couldn't tell them where I got them. So I told my dad, "Hey, Dad, I went to the pharmacy, which also had toys, and I bought myself some guns to go with my G.I. Joes." "Oh, okay, Nathan." And he looked it over, and he was looking it over, and he was looking it over, and he pointed, and there was a tiny, tiny, itty-bitty, almost microscopic logo for Kmart. And my heart dropped. Because I was busted. And my dad said to me, "Now, Nathan, I'm going to spank you. And you're not going to remember the pain of being spanked. But you are going to remember the pain that you lied to me." That was 30 years ago. 35 years ago. And I remember. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. True? False. I remember that I lied to my dad. Because words are powerful. It was God's word that created everything. Created you and me, the world, the sky, the stars, and everything that we have in our lives. It's a gift of the word of God. God's word created everything. And our words, we are made in the image and likeness of God, our words create the world in which we live. I construct my family, my church, my living, my career. I construct the life around me by the words that I speak. As a parent, as a husband, as a pastor, I'm ever mindful of the power of my words. I'm ever mindful that my words have the power to bring life And my words have the power to cut and to hurt, to determine the life of our church, to determine the life of my family, to determine the destiny of my children. James talks about this power of our words, and he uses a number of images. He says that the mouth is a small thing. It's a small thing with outsized impact because of the way that it affects everything else. He says the mouth is like a small fire that sets ablaze. How many of you have ever said something and you thought that it would have this much impact? You know, you wanted it to burn just a little bit. You know what I'm talking about? I'm going to say this, it's going to burn just a little bit. And then all of a sudden, it just gets out of control. And you feel like you're standing in the middle of just like a charred field, that you have like a forest fire. You know, somebody just didn't douse the fire and they burned down half of California. Have you ever done that? Have you ever been around when that happens? He says that that the tongue is like a stain. Your stain is a small thing. If I spilled a little coffee on my shirt, how much of my shirt is clean? 95%? But you know what I'm going to do if I pour my coffee on the front of my shirt on the way to work? I'm going to turn around and go back to the house. Because the stain has ruined the whole thing. The whole shirt has to be cleansed. He says the mouth is like the bridle that's in the mouth of a horse, the bit that's between its teeth. And the horse is a large and powerful animal, much more powerful than the rider. And yet, because there's been a control that's been placed upon the mouth, then the rider has the ability to guide that horse wherever he or she wants it to go. James is teaching us that if God can control our mouth, he can have control of all of us. He talks about a ship, a huge ship that has a small rudder and it guides the direction. He's teaching us that our mouth gives direction to all of our lives. No matter how well we have the ship put together, if we have a mouth that guides us in the wrong way, then we won't go where we want to go. James says something that's profound and something I think about often. He says that if you find a person who is perfect in their speaking, a person who makes no mistake in the things that they say, then that person is perfect all the way through. If there's a person whose words are perfect, then that person is perfect all the way through. Isn't that fascinating? Isn't that something to think about? And why is that? Because our words, as Miss Janie told us today, you know, and after the children's sermon, we could have said amen and gone home. That's so good. The words are a reflection of our heart. And as much as we try, if our heart is imperfect, then the imperfection of our heart is going to be reflected in the imperfection of our words. As a matter of fact, you might say, I said that, but I didn't mean it. Because that's because we lie to ourselves about the nature of our heart. And when we are pressed, and something comes out of our mouth that we don't think is consistent with our character, it is a time for self-diagnosis. It's an opportunity to go before God and say, thank you for showing me where my heart needs to be cleansed. Purify my heart. And James says this. He says, the same spring can't have at the same time brackish water and fresh water, and yet from the same mouth we speak both blessing and cursing. He says it ought not to be so, but is it so? Is it so? Let's be honest. Is it so? Is it so? It is so. It's not to cast stones, it's to be honest before each other and before God. I wish that my mouth only spoke blessings, But sometimes it's blessings and sometimes it's cursings. Sometimes it's fresh water and sometimes it's brackish water. And as much as I try, my heart is imperfect. I try to train myself to do better. I read books like every year I read Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence People. And you know what my great takeaway is? Smile, shut up, and say something nice. And I'm like, smile, keep smiling, keep smiling. Don't say what you're thinking, don't say what you're thinking. And it works for a little while. Every year I read Life Together by Dietrich Bonhoeffer, and he talks about how you should never complain. Never complain. A pastor should never complain, especially about the church or any church person, not even to God himself. I'm like, oh. He says, what? What? He says, God did not give a pastor or congregation to be its accuser before God and men. That's all. I'm so sorry. And I do better. I do better. And I think about my mentor, Lawson Bryan, who had a trained mouth. You know, anytime he was in a situation and he wanted to say something like this, like the natural reaction would be to say, why in the world are we doing it this way? Instead, he would say, teach me about how we came to do it this way. That's a trained mouth. You know what I mean? He was so good. And I say, oftentimes I tell myself, what would Lawson say? What would Lawson say? What would Jesus do? And what would Lawson say? But my mouth is inconsistent. On the one hand, you know, I was talking to Shauna just yesterday about what we're talking today, and she said, oh, I can't wait to hear that. She said, remember when you had the Bible study in the prison and you were the only person speaking life to those ladies? Everybody else was telling them that they were garbage and that they were never going to get out of that place. And every week you spoke life. She was working in the same prison. I was like, man, yeah, that's good, that's good. But then there was this other time. There was this other time. And before Matthew knew me, he knew about this. There was this other time that the bishop had all the pastors come to a continuing education event with this speaker whose work I had read prior. And let's just say, I think that the man is full of hot air, okay? And at that time, I had a Twitter account. And I was live tweeting snarky comments about the ridiculous stuff that this man was saying. And I could look down the row at all my friends and they were like... See, because I was a class clown when I was a little boy, I told you all about that. And that was fun. And now every time we have a continuing education event, somebody says, are you going to be tweeting? I was like, man, I want to. But I deleted my Twitter. I deleted my Twitter because of the prayer that says, lead us not into temptation. Lead us not into temptation. From the same mouth can come both life and death, blessing and cursing, that might even describe your mouth. If it describes mine, it might describe yours. And so today, as we're confronted with this word, the question I want us to present before God and the question I want God to teach us about is this: how can our speech become more perfect? How can our heart become more perfect so that our speech might become more perfect? How might God redeem our heart, and as He is redeeming our heart, also redeem our words? And for that, I want us to go back to where we began today. That's the beginning of the book. It's the beginning of the series. It's the thesis statement of the book of James. James chapter 1:17, every generous act of giving with every perfect gift is from where? Above. Coming down from whom? the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. God is good all the time and all the time. God is good. Yes, yes, God is good. There's no variation due to change. God is good always. And so when we talk about words, here's my question. What good word has God given us? And how are the words that God has given to us perfect gifts? God's word about you is a perfect gift. What has He said about us that is blessing and not cursing? God's word over you is not death, it's life. It is through God's word that we were first given life. It is through God's word that we have been given new life. God's word is good. In Disciple Bible Study, we're talking about the beginning right now. And it begins on the first week with Genesis chapter 1. God creates everything, and then He creates you, and He says, it is. What is God's word over you? God's word over you is good. God's word over you is blessing. God's word over you is life. It is His good work that gave you life. We know that we are sinners. That's true. We know that we are fallen. But God's word over you is good. And it is God's word that gave you life. And when you had fallen, God's word gave you new life. God's word is a perfect gift. When God speaks a good word over you, when God says you are redeemed, when God says you are holy, is that always a description of reality? No. But it's true because it is a word that brings new reality into existence. When God says you are holy, it is His proclamation of holiness that transforms you into the image and likeness of His Son. God's word is powerful. That is the power of blessing. God's word shapes rather than reflects reality. That's the power of blessing. And God has given you a blessing with the words He has spoken over you. He has called you by name. He has loved you with an eternal love. He has spoken a good word by calling you His child. He's called you holy. He's called you redeemed. He's called greatness out of you. And if He's done that for me, then it can change the way that I talk about my world, about the people in my world. See, if my heart is inconsistent, if my heart is imperfect, if my understanding is muddled and incomplete and affected by whether I've had my coffee yet, right? Then my speech is always going to be mixed. It's not always going to be consistently blessing. But if I can get a hold of the reality that God has spoke blessing upon me and His word about me is good, and I can have God's heart redeeming my heart, I can recognize that the power of God has been placed in my mouth. Because I've been given this great gift and this great responsibility, this great power, I can learn to increasingly speak blessing. Speak not my word, but speak God's word. If I will look with God's eyes on my church, on my community, if I'll look with God's eyes on my family, on my friends, then I can speak what God has to say about them. You know this is true, particularly if you're a parent. You know, I know that When I talk to my children, either the 20-year-old or the 7-year-old, you know, they receive my words very differently, let me tell you. But I know that when I speak to them about themselves, when I say, you are fill in the blank, that it is a description of who they are, but it also shapes who they are. If I use words that curse them, then those curses can be very difficult for them to overcome. True? Whew, those words are hard to forget. They're hard to redeem. But if I speak blessing upon my children, I can call out what God has placed within them, and it nurtures God's blessing upon them. You've seen this in your life with your own parents. You've seen it with your children. Do y'all know what I'm talking about? Yes. And if it's true with our children, it's true with everything else in our lives. My little girl's identity is shaped by the words of her father. I dare not speak words of curse. I must recognize the power of blessing and speak words of blessing. And this is what James teaches us. A new way of understanding the power of our words. He says this. He says, how can I bless God who I haven't seen? But the way that I see God in the world is through the human beings that he has made in his image and likeness. And how can I bless God who I haven't seen and curse the only image of the unseen God that I have, which is his people? I can't. Each person that you meet is a reflection of the glory of God. Each person that you meet is an expression of the love of God's heart. And if you can't say something good about them for who they are, then find a way to bless them for that of God within them that they cannot shake no matter how hard they try. And may God use that. James says, I dare not curse that which God has blessed. I dare not curse that which God has blessed. We align our words with God's words. There's power. There's power to restore God's intended reality. Not because you ought and not because you should, but because God has spoken life to you, this is my challenge. See with a different eye. Look for God's good gifts. Speak life. Speak life. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In closing, hymn is number 536. We'll stand, we'll sing all the verses. If anyone would like to come before the Lord and pray, the altar is open, and I invite you to come. Let's stand as we sing together, number 536, Precious Name.
Go forth in peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.